Double Acts by John Finnemore. This week, Stephanie Cole as Victoria and Kerry Godleyman as Mabel in The Queen's Speech. This is a cylinder of wax covered with faint jagged marks. It is in a Ziploc bag inside a cardboard box at the back of a shelf in the overflow storage facility at the Museum of Science in Hobart. It's an early recording, but there's no way of playing it or telling what's on it. Which is a shame, because as it happens, it's the only recording in existence of the voice of Queen Victoria. And if you could play it, this is what you would hear.
Eggs! Undocket! Ubla! Naha! Hi! Tiger! Tiger! Because the tube stinks, Mrs. Nesbitt!
Oh, that was... And shorter than I was hoping. Tell you what, to fill in the time. This is the blue withdrawing room of Osborne House, Queen Victoria's residence on the Isle of Wight in 1886. At the doors, three ladies in waiting are, well, waiting, and at the centre table sits Her Majesty the Queen, going through the afternoon's business with her private secretary.
Listen to this, Sir Samuel. The Prime Minister cannot entirely reproach himself with having failed to caution Your Majesty as to the likely repercussions. Or in so many words, Mr. Gladstone says told you so. Well, we shall make answer. Meanwhile, this by cipher to Lord Rosebery concerning the Greek question, this to the Guild of Mercers, decline, this to the Master of Balliol, decline, this to the King of Norway, accept, but he must come here, and this to the City of Winnipeg. Where is Winnipeg? Winnipeg, Winnipeg. Oh, heavens, decline. Aha! 3 o'clock, time for our treat. Ladies, you may join us. Today, if I mistake not, we are to have a conjurer. Oh, pray do not give me your doleful look, Sir Samuel. I am aware our time is scarce, but no doubt the conjurer can produce all his doves within 10 minutes. And if he cannot, why then he must produce as many as he can and leave the rest in his hat. Ring for him. Oh, who are you?
Your Majesty.
You're not a conjurer.
Your Majesty.
Or are you? Are there lady conjurers?
Your Majesty.
There ought not to be, I think. There is mystery innate in woman, but it is surely ill spent in the production of flags of all nations.
Your Majesty.
What?
I am not a conjurer.
No?
No, ma'am. Leastways not in the professional line.
Oh, Bessie, hand me my day book.
Though I do a bit in the amateur way, as it happens, coins from kiddies' ears and so on, but not what you might call an
actual... Silence, madam.
Oh, right you are.
We have penetrated the mystery. This is the wrong day.
The wrong day?
Yes. We find we commanded Mr. Maskelyne to appear on Thursday.
But this is Wednesday.
Precisely. The day is wrong.
The day is wrong?
Indeed. That being so, it follows that so far from being a conjurer, you are, in fact, Mr. Alfred Nesbitt of Acton.
Am I now?
Oh, confound this book.
His wife, ma'am, Mrs. Mabel Nesbitt of Acton. Also, naturally.
Ah, his wife. Yes, yes. And where is he?
Alas, ma'am, poor Alf is took sick and mayn't leave his bed, but...
Took I've sick? Come to... That's bad. Very bad.
Thank you, ma'am. I appreciate
it. Is it contagious? Have you brought it in?
Oh, no, ma'am. It's not contagious.
Are you sure? Quite sure.
Tolerable, sure, ma'am. Yes, there ain't much to be said for being kicked by a horse, but I never heard of it catching.
Ah, good, good. Our best wishes to your husband.
Much obliged. But not to worry, ma'am. You'll find I can work the machine quite as well as he.
The machine? What machine?
The machine has brung me here, ma'am. Well, I brung it, but first it brung me, if you follow.
We do not follow.
I mean, ma'am, the very thing you asked Mr. Nesbitt up here to show you. The new wonder of the age. Nesbitt's speaking machine.
Oh, like the telephone.
No, ma'am, not the least bit like.
Mrs. Nesbitt, we are not used to being directly contradicted.
Oh, ain't you?
No.
Well, then, not exactly.
Better?
Not exactly at all. Mr. Bell's telephone merely sends the voice across distance. My husband's machine actually sets down the speakings in wax to be reproduced again in the very tones and voices it was spoke.
And we commanded your husband to demonstrate it, did we?
You did, ma'am.
Why ever should I have done so? Where even would I have learned of it?
Your Majesty might have seen it wrote up in the Illustrated London News.
Oh, yes, the mechanical parrot.
It is not a parrot, ma'am. The gentleman as wrote it up was pleased to play Tom Fool.
But it says back what you say to it.
Yes, ma'am.
And it is fashioned to resemble a parrot.
No, ma'am, it ain't. That was all the illustrator's fancy.
Well, well. Where is it, at any rate?
He said I weren't to fetch it in unless you said that you'd like to see it.
He said? Who said?
The pink gent in the fluffy whiskers.
There's you, Sir Samuel, to the life. Well, yes, yes, by all means, bring it in, bring it in.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, come, come, Sir Samuel. Don't give me the sheep's eye. After all, you know you are pink. Oh, great heavens. The thing's gargantuan. Maisie, ring for footman.
No, ma'am, if you please. The machine is delicate. I won't let anyone move it but me.
It doesn't look delicate. However did you get it here?
By train, ma'am. Three trains and a ferry.
Why, surely you could as well have demonstrated it to us in London.
Yes, ma'am. So I thought too, the palace being not a mile from our carriage works. But here's where I was invited, so here's where I've come.
Commanded?
Eh?
You were not invited, madam. You were commanded.
What? So if I hadn't have come, you'd have sent the army to fetch me?
Naturally not that.
Well, then, you invited me then, didn't you?
Are we ever to see this wretched machine, Mrs. Nesbit, or are we not? Off with the cloth, madam.
All right, keep your head... I mean, Your Majesty, I proudly present Nesbit's speaking machine.
Oh.
Ma'am?
Mrs. Nesbit, you told me it was not in the shape of a parrot, madam. You neglected to mention it was in the shape of an elephant.
It's no such thing.
It is, just like a little elephant with its great wooden body and metal legs and its vast ungainly ear and its trunk.
That is the speaking tube, ma'am.
It speaks through it.
No, you speak into it. It then reproduces the sound through this horn.
So, it listens with its nose and speaks through its ear. Oh, heaven save the poor creature. And what's that it sits upon? Why, it looks like a sewing machine table.
Well, of course it do, for that's just what it is, as any fool may see.
Mrs. Nesbit, I fear you quite forget yourself.
Not meaning you by that, ma'am, naturally not. But Your Majesty has, most cleverly, put her finger right on the central wonder of the invention. There's no electrical current, no magnetic field. It is purely mechanical. And it may be worked by anyone with a pair of legs.
Madam!
Beg pardon, anyone with the suitable equipment. The operator simply sets down here.
You are quite comfortable, I hope, Mrs. Nesbit.
Oh, yes, quite. It's no harder than a bench.
One does not generally seat oneself before one's monarch without invitation.
Oh, may I
be? Yes, yes.
Now, the treadle, see, rotates the cylinder. Meanwhile, one speaks into the tube and the voice is directed to the diaphragm, see? Tight as a drum, holding a steel engraving pick. This by means of a traversing screw.
You seem most au fait with your husband's device, Mrs. Nesbit.
Yes, well, Alf's a very good teacher.
You certainly know far more about the intricacies of the mechanism than I should care to.
Ah, but that's it, you see. It ain't intricate at all when you get down to it. The engraving pick, see, that's mounted
far
on a...
Far more, I repeat, than I should care to.
Yes, ma'am, I see. Well, then I'll just show you it working, shall I?
Capital.
So, I work the treadle and speak into the tube like so. God save the Queen. And now I remove the engraving pick, engage the reading pick and...
Tube like so. God save the Queen.
The voice is reproduced.
I see. Rather a lot of ado when you might simply have said it twice.
No, but...
Well, thank you, Mrs. Nesbit. Most illuminating.
But it ain't just like saying it twice. That's on forever now.
An elephant never forgets, eh?
Oh. This cylinder, for instance, this holds the voice of my husband, exactly as he spoke 6 months since.
Mrs. Nesbit.
What, isn't it you? Well, what shall I say? Hey, diddle, diddle. Crack, bring the fiddle.
You see? And the cylinders can be sent anywhere, and the voice heard as if it were in the very room.
Always allowing that the recipient has such a machine themselves.
Yes, of course.
Are there many such machines extant?
Only this one yet, but...
I see. Our thanks once again.
No, but you must hear this last cylinder.
We must do nothing.
But this last holds the voice...
Mrs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.